Hoorah, everybody. Black is back.
Black is back.
Say, black is back.
Black is back.
Black is back. Say it like it is. Is it or is it not? Black is back.
Black is back.
All right, that's what we need. Like Sister Aisha just announced, the name of this workshop is Challenging the Bourgeois Electoral Monopoly. We have been talking, and I think not a minute too soon, we have been really looking at this whole question of the electoral process and our participation in it. And I think that especially right now, you know, where we see campaigns calling for people to vote like your life depended on it, we have to help our people to understand what it means and how we should approach this question. And I think we had some good discussions. We had a brilliant political report this morning that kind of shed light on how we can empower ourselves when we approach this whole question of the electoral process. This workshop would have presentations made by three panelists, and then subsequent to that, we are going to use the 15 minutes to get some resolutions. And people will be able to ask questions, have participation in the plenary part of the process. The first person that's going to present on this workshop is Chimurenga Waller. And Chimurenga Waller is a NCC member of the African People Socialist Party. He's on our central committee. And he's no stranger to the whole question of the electoral process. Chimurenga himself was a former candidate for Pinellas County School Board in St. Petersburg, Florida. And he was also a candidate for the St. Petersburg City Council. And Chimurenga took the aspirations of the community, the African community in Pinellas County, St. Petersburg, took it into that process and shook up that process because we went in on our own terms and began to make everybody respond to us in terms of, you know, what the community needed. And all the candidates had to speak to that question. The other person that we're going to bring up to this panel is activist and Councilman Charles Barron. And brother Councilman Charles Barron is representing the 42nd District in New York City. And I remember when I first met Councilman Barron, which was many, 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 many years ago on Atlantic Avenue in the Black United Front. Yourself, myself, and Aranda Takuma. But you know, here we have him today, and he's gonna give you some insights and talk about the courageous battles that he waged in terms of, in the interest of the African community in New York City. The last person on the panel, everybody's heard about since we've been here and even before we've been here, and that is brother Chairman Lawrence Hamm, whose organization, is he here? Oh, there he is. And this is the chairman of the organization, the People's Organization for Progress, POP as we call it, that had just successfully completed 381 consecutive days of protest in New Jersey. POP's People's Campaign for Jobs, Peace, Equality, and Justice built an opposition to the oppressive public policies, including economic policies and practices that exploited the African community and colonial wars carried out by the United States government. And that was a magnificent, magnificent mobilization. It taught us that, you know, like in the olden days, we had staying power, we can be effective. So these are the three panelists. And I just want you to give him a hand, and then we'll move on into the first discussion. Chimurenga, you'll be the first person.
Uhuru. As Gaida said, I'm Chimurenga Waller. I belong to the African People's Socialist Party. And as she mentioned, I was a candidate for city council twice and also for the Pinellas County School Board in 2000. We learned a lot of things during that period of running in elections. We hadn't done that much as a strategy for moving the liberation of African people forward. And in 2000, in the county where I'm from in Pinellas County, a lot of issues around education with African people. And of course, that's everywhere. You will find that. In Pinellas County, you may be aware that the highest rate of African men not graduating with regular diplomas is in Pinellas County. St. Petersburg, Florida, where our national headquarters is located in Pinellas County. So we have a dire situation there in terms of education. And in 1998, we actually put forward a charter school program that Pinellas County School Board said was one of the best they had ever seen, and then they promptly denied it. And they denied it because they said it was going to be a majority African school and that that was not be allowed in Pinellas County. And then, although they had no such rules to that effect at the time, later on, they went to a judge who said, make up some rules, and then they made up some rules to say, no, you can't have this charter school. So that was the context in which we ran somebody for Pinellas County School Board, and it was interesting because I didn't know a lot about running for office. I had never done that before. And I remember when I went into the first candidate forum, all I had was a business card. And I didn't have a flyer, a poster, anything. I didn't have a clue what I was supposed to be doing, right? So I went in there with my wife. Anybody know anything about Pinellas County in Florida? Well, it's a very white county, I can tell you that. So the northern part of the county is even whiter. So I was in a place called Topper Springs at the first candidate forum I went to. And me and my wife was the only black people in there. It was about 300 people in there. So when I got up to speak, I started saying, well, the real issues in this campaign is that African children are not being educated, that the whole education system is hostile to African children. It was a very silent kind of response, to say the least. But a very interesting thing happened at the end of that forum. It took me about 30 minutes to leave there, because the white people mobbed me. They didn't try to kill me. What happened was, because it was a Republican Party campaign forum, they felt like I was making the criticism of the NAACP and this desegregation order that they couldn't do. So they felt like, hey, this is the guy that we need. So they tried to recruit me into the Republican Party. I was like, no, that won't work. What we did was say, what we have here is a convergence of interest. We don't believe that busing African children all over Pinellas County is going to get African children educated. And you don't want busing either, but you don't want it for a different reason. And I don't really care. If both of us have a convergence of interest, that's how we move. You don't have to love me. And it really excited a lot of voters about saying, look, this is about practical interest. This is not about whether you like me or I like you. Although it upset a number of the candidates. And interestingly enough, some of the candidates were saying, you can't keep saying that. You can't keep saying that black students are being failed in Pinellas County. You can't keep saying that. I was like, why not? Well, you can't say that because nobody will vote for you. Well, I said, I'm going to tell the truth and see what happens. So we did that. We got about 10,000 votes in that election. About, 10,000 votes. It's about 10% of the vote. But it was a very interesting campaign, and we ran it on little experience, little money. The candidate didn't have a clue what he was doing, but we had a program and we did it based on the interests of the African community, and our organization made that decision. Different from when people just jump up and say, I want to be a candidate for this and that, our organization sat down and said, these are the issues we need to drive, so we're going to run somebody for school. And that's what I hope one day that the Black is Back will do. They will start searching for their own candidates, identifying candidates within the organization who can make those kind of moves, groom them along the way, and then we create our own candidates. Because we are not in a position where we can depend on the Cory Bookers of the world to, you can't. You can't say, let me tell you a little story. I remember somebody came to one of our meetings during the campaign in 2008 for the presidential campaign, and the woman was really disturbed by our position around Barack Obama. She pleaded with us, well, you know, he can't say certain things because he hasn't been elected yet. So after he gets elected, then he'll be able to say all these things. But Barack Obama meant exactly what he said, and he had no interest for African people whatsoever, and his commercials prove that, of course. Did you ever see anybody Black in any of the commercials that Barack Obama ran? No. So the interest of the African community is really what we were fighting for, and that's what we told the person who was at our meeting, and that's what we have to do. And when we challenge the bourgeois dominance over the electoral politic, we have to enter these elections with our own candidates. That is absolutely going to be necessary, because some of the things that were mentioned earlier by some of the other workshop presenters, such as gerrymandering, that happened. In 2005, I ran for the St. Petersburg City Council, and right before that election, they actually changed the district so that it would no longer be 58% African. They changed it to be 53% African. Now, an African named Ernest Williams had been appointed to that seat shortly before the election. And guess who signed off on the paper to change it from 58 to 53%? Ernest Williams. Now, Ernest Williams is not a very smart man. We knew that going in. He's just an empty suit. He didn't know anything. And I'm not sure he knew his district was going to be 53% African. Some white person probably came to him and said, boy, sign this paper. And he signed the paper. And then he almost lost an election because he did. As a matter of fact, he lost the primary to a white woman. And the St. Petersburg Times and the other financial interests went crazy. I was in that election as well. There were three other candidates besides the white woman and Ernest Williams. And that election, I should tell you, got very interesting. And it was connected to my 2001 run for city council, in which I finished second among five candidates. And I got into a runoff. It was a big disparity in votes, but I got into a runoff. And the St. Petersburg Times newspaper wrote these articles. I think that was the time the chairman was running for mayor. He wrote these articles saying, well, the Uhurus don't have any support. And what the story really was, how did a candidate with a radical platform calling for rent controls, calling for economic development in the African community as opposed to economic extraction, how could a candidate like that end up in a runoff with a status quo candidate? Not how we lost by such a large margin. So when we start defining what victory is, it doesn't always mean, like was mentioned earlier, doesn't always mean that we're gonna have more votes than the other people. Sometimes we're gonna drive issues, sometimes we're going to drive issues and make everybody else discuss it. And that is what has happened in, this, in the elections that I have run in. I would say that what we will see happening, and I think we should really have this discussion so we know what is going to be in the discussion as we identify candidates, groom them, and run them in an election. When I ran for the school board, there was a Republican and a Democrat. These are nonpartisan elections in Pinellas County. But when I ran, there were Democrats and Republicans fundraising for all the other candidates, and you know, to stop me. After I got into the runoff in the city council, for city council, both Republican and Democrats were fundraising together to stop me. So it proved the two sides are not that different. They're the same thing. It's just two faces of the different of the same thing. So in 2005, when I ran for city council, that was a very interesting election. Now, I was coming out of the 2001 election where I'd gotten into the runoff. So the bourgeoisie, they were very intimidated by the possibilities that I could win that election. And so they wrote about the election sort of in general and, you know, sort of wrote about me as this anomaly among these candidates. But in the last 8 days of the election for city council, they wrote 10 articles with my name in it. 10. And none of them said that I was the right candidate. All of these articles were attacking articles. You know, they were using your windows and saying, well, this person came to the campaign forum and said, made anti-gay remarks, and he was, that person was with campaign people from the Waller campaign. It was just an attack, a blistering attack. You would have thought it was a presidential election. So these are the kind of things that we will have to face as we move forward. But that's what helps us to understand that we don't just run a candidate necessarily to win the election. We are winning our objectives. That's what we have to put in place as we pick our candidates and groom them. So there's going to be a resolution. I have one myself that I would like to put forward in terms of the strategy of the Black is Back for challenging the bourgeois dominance of these, of electoral politics. Gaida, I don't know if it's time for the, would you like to get everybody up there first before we do? Okay. Okay. But, uh-huh. So I think that, I think the way the chairman described it was a great strategy. It cannot be the only strategy that we use. Electoral politics is only one strategy that we use to make this fight happen for the liberation of African people. It is cannot be a singular strategy. So what we want to do is put it in an arsenal, so to speak, of all kinds of things, on the ground outreach, forums, events, demonstrations, all of that go into that pool of tactics that we use to liberate our people. And of course, we'll talk about other options later, but I think that we have to be clear that electoral politics can be and is an important tactic to use as we move forward. It allows us to put the issues that we believe in, the issues of liberation of African people, reparations, all those kind of issues on the table. Charles Barron has done that in New York. The unfortunate thing is not that many Charles Barrons. That's the problem. So what we have to do is organize that to change that. So our organization is the actual institution that's building candidates, promoting them, funding them. That way they're not, you know, obligated to Wall Street and all these other corporations. They're not obligated to anybody but the African community. So I want to express my appreciation for people listening to me. There are plenty of stories that I could tell about Pinellas County. It has a very strange electoral system in city council. They have at-large voting in the general election, and then they have single-member district voting for the primary, which is crazy. Only the district can vote in the primary, and then in the general election, it's at-large voting. All these white people get to vote for the black candidate, so if they don't like them, they can reverse the decision of the black people. So it's a very interesting situation, but I want to express my appreciation to Current Secretary General Gaita Cambone and all of you in the Black is Back for inviting me to give some of my experiences and my input into this process. Uh-huh.
I want to thank Chimurenga for that presentation. And one thing that it, as you were presenting, and I was sitting there, that it really brought up for me is the significance of the BIB coalition. Because if we're going to be in this process, we have to be in it strategically. And I think the thing that Chimurenga was talking about in terms of how we can really get everywhere we are, begin to groom people and put them in there to get our agenda and these platforms all around the country. You know, I think that's a really important thing. That's not something that we should play down. Next, I want to bring up Councilman Charles Barron, who's going to be our next presenter.
Uhuru. Black power. Black is back. You know, I'm glad y'all talking black, because this show is lonely out here sometimes. Not hearing people want to talk black. People talking about race neutral politics. You know, race neutral politics means you're supporting white nationalism, because there's nothing neutral. It can't be neutral. Race neutral politics means you're supporting white interests. I want to talk about my city council stuff and my last congressional run. I'm still going to my mailbox traumatized to see what kind of mail is coming in. And I'm nervous and open up the newspapers, not knowing what I might see. But I'm recovering, y'all. I'm recovering. It was fun. See, you know what? I had to get mad at me, because I don't let that faze me in the least. They think they be hitting you, and they think you're wounded. Then when I see them, I say, hey, how y'all doing? Yeah. We gonna get you next time, you know? See you in the streets. When I run around the streets, you would thought I won. Because I did. I got 11,000 votes in spite of all of that stuff. I did win. I got to acknowledge the chairman, Omali Yeshiteli. You know, it's a breath of fresh air when you still have people committed to revolution, to radical change, to reparations, freeing political prisoners, and still engaging in the electoral arena with that, not changing to win, but demanding to win on our terms. So, Chairman, I congratulate you for that, and I commend you for that. To one of my heroes, who was in the audience with his wife, Amina, Mary Baraka. He is a hero of mine, and one that I, give it up for Mary. He's been out there for a while for us. I do appreciate you and Sister Amina for all the work that y'all have done, and your son, Ross Baraka, for being in Newark. I think there's about 277,000 people in Newark, and 90 or 80% of them are black and Latino, 50-some-odd percent black, I think 30-some-odd percent Latino. They have 9 members on the city council, 5 blacks, 4 Latinos. We just got to get everybody black, and everybody Latino, so they could join Ross, and we can get something done. That's the problem. And I'm going to talk about that in a minute. So it's good to have him. And my brother Larry Hamm, I've always, always been inspired by your work. And Brother Chimurenga, keep running, man. And he's talking about he got 10,000 votes. I didn't get that many to win my city council seat, man. When 10,000 people, and I think I saw this in Brother Ford's articles, when 10,000 people vote for one of us, they're voting for radical politics. They're voting for radical politics. So they're making a statement that we're ready. We just got to get our apparatus better so that we can reach more with our message, because people are ready to hear us. You know, I've been rereading a book that I read in the 60s by Dr. Osagyefo Kwame Nkrumah, and that is Neocolonialism, the Last Stage of Imperialism. Neocolonialism, the Last Stage of Imperialism. And that's what we're up against. That's what we're up against. That's what we're up against. So when we get out there, you know, you may not even face white folk anymore. You gotta face the neo-colonial puppets that are in the city councils, that are in the state assemblies, that are in the White House, that are in the congressional seats. So when you know that in Africa, when the colonists were there, literally, whites were there, the prime ministers took over the political system, the economy, the navy, the army, and everything, they were there, then when the overwhelming majority of Africans started to rise up in Mau Mau movements and Sekou Touré and Julius Nyerere and Kwame Nkrumah, when they all started rising up, then the white colonialists said, wait a minute, we lost. We gotta find another way to control. So let's get some black puppets. Set up a black puppet government, give them a flag, let them have political power or positions, but that economy, the land, the army, the police, we will control from Europe. We're gonna go back to the world, we're gonna leave. And you know, anytime somebody grants you independence, you're not free. If you don't take it, you're not free. You're not free. So they went through that period, but the good thing about neocolonialism, if there's anything good that can come out about it, the good thing about it is that you gotta front black people now, because you're losing. Because you're losing, so you have to put forth a black face on white policies and issues and interest, because people have peeped your whole card. The whole world is rising up against you. So now you have to put a face on it to make it appear that we're making progress. So in New York City, a city of 8 million people, 2.7 million Latinos, 2.3 million Latinos, this is their statistics, so you just gotta add stuff to their statistics, 2.3 million Latinos, 1.8 million Africans, 1 million Asians, and 2.7 million whites. 2.7 million whites. Blacks, Latinos, and Asians are 62% of New York City. That's why maybe I shouldn't have gone to Washington. I'm gonna stay right there in New York City and handle my business. We'll see. Then you have a city council. See, this is why I want to propose to us a city council strategy across the country. That's very local, very doable. Very doable. It's going to be more challenging to get the congressional seats and the statewide seats or become a governor or a mayor. Those can happen, but that's going to be a little more challenging. But on the city council levels across the country, we are the majority in a lot of places in this country. Newark is one of them. We just got to get Ras Baraka 8 more of us. Because he's there by himself, radical, conscious, with 8 neo-colonialists. So we have to get Ras Baraka, start help him in his movement here, to get 2 or 3 more African conscious, radical, revolutionary people on the city council here in Newark. Especially in a city where we're 80% of the population. Then there's Brother Chokwe Lumumba. In Jackson, Mississippi, 183,000 people in Jackson, 80% of them are black. They only have 7 city council members, and Chokwe is one of them. We just got to get rid of the 6 neo-colonialists to help Chokwe out. I'm thinking we do a, Chairman, if we do a national city council local strategy, because if they can get Chokwe in and Ross in, and I got in New York, and that ain't no easy task, we can now take this all over. Sister Joanne Watson from Detroit, she's a progressive sister, very conscious, black conscious, progressive. There are 9 council members in Detroit. 82% of the population in Detroit is African, black people. All 9 council members are black, but there's only 1 or 2 real blacks. We gotta get rid of the other 6 or 7 neo-colonialists. We gotta get rid of the neo-colonialists. We gotta get rid of the neo-colonialists. Come to New York City, I live in the most powerful city on the planet. The richest city on the planet is New York City. We, people of color, blacks, Latinos, and Asians, are the new majority in the population, even with the miscount. We're the majority. In the last election in November, 56% of the people that actually came out to vote were us. So we're even the majority that comes out to vote. City Council, we have 51 members of the City Council in New York. The power of the City Council, we pass the budget, not the mayor. Y'all can talk about Bloomberg all you want. He doesn't have a vote on the budget. He can only propose it, like they do in most places. Where do they propose the city's budget to? The City Council. Newark, the City Council. Everywhere, it's the City Council. And the good thing about the City Council strategy, if you deal on a federal level, you're talking about a bicameral system, a House and a Senate, 435 members of the House of Representatives, 43 blacks, 100 US senators, no blacks. None. 535 members of Congress, 43 in the House, none in the Senate. You can't get nothing passed unless you pass it the House and the Senate. On the state level, there's an Assembly and a Senate, bicameral. New York City, we got 150 members of the Assembly, 63 members of the Senate. Only 40-some-odd% of them are black and Latino, and only 13 of the senators are black and Latino. Bicameral. And the City Council is a unicameral body. One body. You don't have to go to another house, a senate, or nothing. It's one body. You get the majority of the votes in that, that's it. So in New York, we have a $68.5 billion budget. You hear what I said? New York City's budget is larger than every African country's budget. New York City's budget is larger than every Caribbean country's budget, every Latin American country's budget, many European countries' budget, many Asian countries. New York City's budget is larger than 48 state budgets in the United States. New Jersey's budget is $29-30 billion. New York City's budget is twice as large as the state of New Jersey. And who sits on New York City Council? 14 blacks. Well, you know, 13 neo-colonialists and 1 African. 14, 11 Latinos, that's 25, 2 Asians, that's 27, and 24 whites. You hear me? 24 whites. We passed the $68 billion budget, we pass all the laws, and we determine land use city-owned land. Do you know, in my black East New York, if Donald Trump came to my neighborhood and said that he wanted to build Trump Towers on Blake Avenue on city-owned land, he has to come see the Black Panther. He has to come see the Black Panther. And I don't bite my tongue. I don't bite my tongue. You know what I have in my office? When all of the white developers have to come, so I don't got to suck up to nobody, they better suck up to me. So when they come, Chairman, I got to invite you to my office so y'all can see it, so you don't think I'm lying. I think I'm fronting for my revolutionary friends. When you come to my office, first you're going to see a red, black, and green flag. You know, I had to battle over that. When I got to my office, they had the American flag in there and the flag of New York City. I'm never going to use the flag of New York City because that's the same flag from South Africa, because the Dutch who colonized South Africa were here in New York City first. Remember? New Amsterdam. So I said, get that flag out of here. And they said, Councilman, no, these are the rules of the city council. You have to have the city council flag and you have to have the American flag. I threw them both out of my office and I have the red, black, and green flag in my office. That was my number one battle. The other thing, I got a chance to visit Venezuela and meet Hugo Chavez and his folk, and I got a chance to go to Cuba and all of that. So I had these nice little heads, you know, these busts of Hugo Chavez, Che Guevara, and Fidel Castro. So I put them right up front, so when the developer has to sit down, you know, he's looking right at them. So, and I always introduce them, meet my three amigos. These are my friends. These are my friends. These are my friends. Then I have a picture of Dr. Khalid Muhammad. I have a picture of, you know, all of the radical, anybody radical I could find. You know, I said, I may not get a vote through, but they're going to have to come to my office and sit through this. But just think, if Donald Trump wanted to do that, he has to come see me. He could have $1 trillion. But he doesn't have the power to build Trump Towers unless he could buy me off. Because the power of the city council member in that direct district, and they all will support you, is the one who decides what's being built on city-owned land. Right now, a black radical revolutionary, Charles Barron, is the number one city council member in building real affordable housing in the borough of Brooklyn. No other council member has done better. None. And I make sure when them developers come in, they say, the councilman, 5 minutes? Oh man, that's just my intro. Okay, let me hurry up. When they come in and they want the land thing, because the land is critical, they show me all these colorful pictures. I said, get out of here. Put the pictures away. How much? How much are you charging my people for rent or that house? And if they don't say it right, this meeting is terminated until you come back with the right price. And then when they come back with the right price, then I said, what is the required income? This is how they do gentrification, through income. What is the AMI, the area median income, required to get in this apartment building? If they tell me 80% of the AMI, I know that's $60,000 for a family of four. My East New York AMI is $28,000. This meeting is terminated. And I get them down to what we need for our community. East New York in New York City is the only black community where the black population increased by 13.2%. Bedford, Stuyvesant, Harlem, everywhere else, gentrified, the black communities' population is going down. And they cite in the Daily News, that beats me up every other day, that is affordable housing that causes the people to want to live in East New York. So brothers and sisters, I think we should go through this electoral movement. Electoral politics is not a panacea. That is not going to get us to the revolutionary ends. This system has to be radically altered. This system has to be restructured so that it is more socialist and human needs over human greed. There's no way See, the failure of some of us when we think policies cannot save capitalism. Radical altering of the entire system in electoral politics is just a tactic that's used. Don't think because they deregulated Wall Street that if we regulate Wall Street, we'll be all right. Don't think because of the lack of policies in this system, if you go that route and think it's deregulation or even taxing the rich, because they'll do that. They'll tax the rich and they'll regulate Wall Street and they'll give you some form of some health care that still has the insurance companies laughing their way to the bank. But the bottom line is until you realize that the problems we're having with the economy, the problems we're having in our community is capitalism itself. It's capitalism itself. So we who believe that have to use this as a tactic to get in it. And while we're raising the issues, whether it's reparations, we need jobs, you know, we need affordable housing, we need health care and all of that, our people are in pain. Part of the failure of our movement is that we're in a dual struggle, a struggle for survival and a struggle for liberation. And 90% of our people are in that struggle for survival, and they don't see our liberation forums like this as a means toward their survival. We haven't made that connection for them yet. So they feel that, hey, y'all can talk all of this radical stuff if you want. I need a job. I need a job. So if I can get in there and I get, no matter what they say, no matter what they, because they can't do anything about this, as a city council member, I ran hard. You know, I was like Chimurenga. I didn't know what I was doing. My first time I ran in 97, I didn't even know you were supposed to call the unions to try to get support. I just was out there running. And I got 4,000 votes. My opponent, incumbent, got 6,000. Then it was an open seat. I stayed out there organizing with my people. You can't win this stuff if you're not connected to the masses. The Black Panther Party taught me you got to meet the needs of the masses, whether you're feeding them breakfast or taking care of their health care. You better produce some needs, because if you don't, the neo-colonialists will. And they will have resources to do it. So when I got in and I finally won by 300 some odd votes, they were saying, how did he do it? Being Black, radical, and whatever your positions is on Robert Mugabe, he has some critique. I brought him to City Hall. They had a fit. I went into the Speaker's office and I said, you know, I need to secure the Red Room. The Red Room is the most prestigious room next to the chambers itself in the city. He said, oh, sure, no problem. I said, it's available? He said, yeah. He said, who are you bringing? I said, a president of an African country. Would you believe that, man? He said, right on, that's nice. Who is it? I said, President Robert Mugabe. He said, no, you're not doing that to me, Charles. I said, doing that to you. See, this is how they think. Why would you bring your politics to me? You? I'm bringing them to City Hall. That's the people's place. It ain't your place. You're just a speaker. I don't see you like the other ones see you. You're just a little facilitator, not a dictator. You know, you said the room is available, then he will be there. He got so angry, he told all the other council members, don't go to that affair. Don't go. So, you know, I pushed it. President Mugabe came, media all over the place, you know, having a little African stuff on. And I was like, come on in, you know, Mr. President. Because the other problem he had is that when he goes back to Zimbabwe and the reactionary forces that they align against him say, look, he couldn't even meet with no politician. He had to go in a church in Harlem because nobody respects this president. Now he can go back and say, I was in the number one city in the world and an elected official brought me into their chambers. Because what I did after I got him into the Red Room, which is the second most prestigious room, I made him go upstairs in the chambers. I said, is the chambers available? They said, well, you didn't secure that. I said, is it available? And they said, yes. I said, come on, y'all, let's go upstairs. So all over they had, oh boy, they talked about me like a dog. But I brought Mugabe there. I get $2 million every year of capital money, so I'm able to renovate parks. I'm able to smooth out some of the streets. 2 million, and that's low. I'm low because I'm fighting, but they don't want to put me too far down. 2 million, I get $400,000 a year to kick out for programs and stuff, and I look for revolutionary people. I get $300,000 a year to hire staff. That's why we could hire Viola Plummer and Omawale Clay and put people on our staff that are revolutionaries. Of course, they fired Viola illegally because her and I was fighting so well. So what we did, we got my wife elected to the state assembly and hired Viola to be her chief of staff. So now Viola's working in her office. They ain't stopping us. Let me wrap it up with this. So we got to do that. I've been able to do a lot, and one day I really want you, the chairman, and I want y'all to come to my East New York one year, and I want to take you around to actually see how we transform the infrastructure of East New York with radical politics. So I want to have that happen so you can see it concretely, and not just at a forum, but see it with your own eyes. Finally, in this last election, the first never before in the annals of New York State politics have they ever aligned the power of forces, powerful forces, to stop one broke candidate. Didn't have no money. I only had $100,000. You need a $500,000 just to finish respectfully. I had $100,000 and 100 workers. And we were working hard. This is a district of 717,000 people, you know. So we worked it. When I was running, they thought I was gonna win. See, this is the second time I ran for Congress. The first time I ran against the incumbent, shocked them with $135,000 to his million. I got 15,000 votes to the incumbent's 19,000. They threw in Roger Green, an assemblyman, his buddy, to take 6,000 votes away from us. The first time the incumbent at Towns was under 50% of the vote, and that was in 2006. We 2008, we got my wife elected. I ran again in 2012. Now when Towns ducked out and was just me and the other brother, and nobody knew him, and all of a sudden, all of the polls were saying I had it. All of the polls were saying I had it. So we was rolling. They panicked. First, the Jews got hysterical because I went to Gaza and I delivered humanitarian aid to suffering people in Gaza. Now, I can tell you all this now because, and my strategy was every time they asked me, you know, about all my past quotes, because I know I said a lot of stuff. So they, when they asked me about the quotes, I said, excuse me, this is a sophisticated level and I want you to talk to me about the complexities of the economic system and foreign policies, not quotes. Because the district is suffering, so I'd rather than say, yeah, I said it, or no, I didn't say it. Didn't you say that Israel was the worst terrorist government in the world? If you want to talk to me about foreign policy, it starts with Africa, not Israel. So let's have this discussion. I said that, y'all. I have to confess, I did say that. They said, did you say Gaza was like the concentration camps that the Israel suffered? I'm not talking about Israel. We're talking about foreign policy. I said that too. They said that, do you want to slap the first white man you see for your black mental health? Now, let me say to y'all that I was at a reparations rally with Viola and them. They got me in trouble. They invited me there. They knew I was a city council member. How dare they invite me to something like that, Chairman? So when I got up, I'll never forget that rally. It was about 60, 70,000 people. And I remember Minister Farrakhan spoke and Jesse and a few others. But the people were like moving around. And I was saying, wow, how come they're not being cool for the speakers? Bob Law was moderating it. So I got up there half playing, half serious. I said, y'all be still. Trying to get our reparations. You walk around, everybody got to tell you to move to the center and be still. Be still. And they got quiet. I said, well, now what am I going to say? So I said, reparations, we marching for reparations. We need to go to the Treasury Department. Let's take our reparations. Now, they don't even have money at the Treasury Department. They just print checks. So I'm just talking trash. And then I said, you know, when I get back to New York for my black mental health, I'm going to slap the first white man I see and tell him it's a black thing. And they're up there, yay! I forgot about ABC, New York One, NBC. So I saw all of that, so I said, oh my God. So when I got back to New York, oh man, the media, my colleagues were saying, where were you this weekend? I said, I was in Washington. They said, well, what did you say? I said, I was talking about reparations. They said, man, they're calling for your head. They want us to vote you out of the city council. Then I had to do this conservative radio program in the morning. I promised them I'd do that. So they got on and they said, Councilman, how are you? How you feeling today? So they want to see how you feeling. I said, great. It's a great time to be alive. I feel great. So they said, we have a quote from the Associated Press. I'm going to slap the first white man I see for my black mental health. Did you say that? I said, absolutely. Absolutely. So they said, well, Councilman, what do you mean by that? So just to mess with them, I said, it was a case of oratorical improvisation and black hyperbole. So they said, oratorical improvisation and black hyperbole. So he said, Mary, he said, what's a black hyperbole? I said, well, sir, a hyperbole is a figure of speech. You know, you have metaphors, you have similes, and you have hyperbole. So I said, hyperbole is a gross exaggeration. That's what a hyperbole is. And he said, well, I know what a hyperbole is. I said, why'd you ask me? So why'd you ask me? He said, tell me what a black hyperbole is. I said, well, when I was growing up, my mama told me on Sunday, if I didn't stop getting on her nerve, she was gonna slap me into Tuesday. I said, now, sir, that didn't mean Monday wasn't gonna happen. That's a hyperbole. And he said, tell me another one. I said, well, my mama told me I brought you in this world. That is not my mother's commitment to murder. That's a hyperbole. That's a hyperbole. So he said, oh, so you were just joking. I said, hey, my mama wasn't playing with me, and I ain't playing with y'all. Black power.
Goodness. Whoa. Hyperbole, huh? Well, okay, next on the agenda, we're going to bring up Chairman Lawrence Hamm.
Black is back. Black is back.
Black
power.
Black power.
Power to the people.
Power to the people.
I'm very glad to be here at this historic Black is Back conference. And let me say, first of all, how fitting it is that we're here today to talk about how to increase black political power through the electoral process. And we have the matriarch and the patriarch of black power here, Amina and Amiri Baraka, sitting in the audience. They are the living heroes of the black power movement, not just in Newark, New Jersey, across the country. And I want everybody to know that I would not be standing here today. I dare say there may not even be a People's Organization for Progress if it wasn't for Amiri Baraka and his contributions. I also want to thank Chairman Omali Yashitela. And I want to tell you something. I was so moved by the fact that you had our daily campaign for jobs, peace, equality, and justice in the Black is Back slideshow, but I want everybody to know that we had the endorsement of 172 organizations for that campaign. But the first organization and the first person to endorse that campaign was Omali Yashitela. And that's when it was just an idea. And I want you to know, Chairman, that when you and I discussed it, it was just a thought. It was an idea. but that we successfully carried out 381 consecutive days of protests for jobs, peace, equality, and justice. And I know all of you thought the campaign was over. The first wave was over. The campaign, the 381-day campaign for jobs, peace, equality, and justice ended on July 11th. We had started on June 27th, 2011. We went 381 days and ended with a massive rally on the 381st day with a large contingent from the Newark branch of Black is Back, and I want you to give them a big hand, the Newark branch of Uhuru in Peetum, Black is Back. But on July the 12th, we held the observance for the Newark Rebellion. See, that's one of our traditions here in Newark, New Jersey. You remember now, there were rebellions all over the country. As a matter of fact, people thought the revolution was right around the corner in the 1960s. Many people don't understand how many rebellions there were. There were over 1,000 urban uprisings in the United States between 1960 and 1972. And in Newark, New Jersey, we don't hide the fact that there was a rebellion. We celebrate the fact there was a rebellion. We celebrate it every year. And we ended the 381-day campaign on July 11th, and on July 12th, we had our observance. And we marched from the spot where we had our daily protests. We marched from there to the monument that has the names of the 26 people who were killed during the rebellion, to try to make that connection between the past and the present, and the fact that the struggle is not over, the struggle continues today, every day. But then on July the 13th, we began a second wave of daily protests. And I am proud to say, brothers and sisters, that when we combine the 381 days with the last 30 days, we've had nearly 425 days of protests here in the city of Newark. And we're going to continue as long as we can, because you all know our history. We embrace electoral politics, but we believe that the primary task is to build the mass movement, and electoral politics must rest on a strong mass movement in our community, a movement in the streets. So I just want to give a little bit of history. We talk about the challenge to electoral politics, the challenge to bourgeois electoral politics. Newark is a good example of that, because we had apartheid here in Newark, New Jersey. Don't call it Jim Crow. If you're gonna call it in South Africa apartheid, call it apartheid here. Call it the same thing. It's a system of racial segregation and domination. And we had that in Newark. We had apartheid in Newark. A predominantly black city only had one black elected representative, and that was Irvin Turner. And then some brothers came together and formed the United Brothers in 1966. And Ken Gibson ran for mayor the first time and lost. But what happened the following year? There was an uprising in Newark. An uprising, and the reason we say uprising and not a riot, because if it was a riot, it could have been put down by the police in a day, maybe less than that. But it was an uprising. All the police couldn't put it down. They had to call in 700 state troopers. They couldn't put it down. They couldn't put it down. They finally had to call in the army. And the army, we know about occupation. We were occupied in Newark, New Jersey by the military, where martial law was declared in this city. And that uprising created the consciousness that was needed to begin the political transformation. And the effort of that transformation was led by Amiri Baraka, first the United Brothers, and then the Committee for a Unified Newark. And they did it through a convention process. See, it just didn't happen. It wasn't just somebody's individual effort. It was a collective effort, a collective effort. It wasn't somebody's personal political ambition only. It was a collective effort. The week after the rebellion, a Black Power conference was held in Newark, New Jersey, while we were under martial law. And then after that, not far from here, just across town, we had the Black Power Convention at West Kenny Junior High School. It's still there. And then after that, we had the Black and Puerto Rican Convention, because we knew we had to make alliances and coalitions to be successful. And out of that effort came the Community's Choice Team. See, they were all together. Sharp James, Ken Gibson, Dennis Westbrooks, and so on. And because we built a broad unity movement out of those conventions, Newark had the first Black mayor of a major East Coast city in 1970. And that's why all these people walking around here today, they want to attack Amiri Baraka. They wouldn't have their jobs if it hadn't been for Amiri Baraka and the Committee for a Unified Newark that got Ken Gibson elected. And we also had a student movement at that time. See, we have to understand the dialectic between the mass movement and the electoral process. We have to have both, because one makes the other stronger. They reinforce each other. And we had a student movement in Newark. And in 1971, students from all over the city marched down and took over the Gateway Hotel. And they were led by a 17-year-old student activist from Arts High named Larry Hamm. Right. And they sent everybody to get the students. We took over the 6th and 7th floors of the Gateway Hotel, the same hotel that's down there across the street from Penn Station, to try to end the teacher strike at that time, to get the board and the union to negotiate. And Ken Gibson came to us and he said, well, if you leave, I'll get the two parties together and we'll end the strike and you guys can graduate and go on and live your lives. And then a month later, when I had just graduated from Arts High School, Ken Gibson asked me to sit on the Board of Education. I became the youngest school board member in the history of the United States of America. I wasn't even old enough to vote, but it wasn't because of my personal desire and ambition. There was a movement. There was a mass movement in the community. There was a student movement. And when you have movement, movement is what makes change. Well, Ken Gibson appointed me, but this young person from Arts High School was appointed. He said his first commitment was to the Black community. And one of the things the students asked they wanted to do was to be able to bring the red, this was in 1971, to bring the red, black, and green flag to school, to be able to put it up in the classrooms. I made a motion on the board. It became the policy. And Ken Gibson said that was the worst appointment he had ever made. This is the truth. But the following year, in 1972, Chairman O'Malley Ashatella mentioned this earlier. There was the National Black Political Convention held in Gary, Indiana. And it was convened by three people at that time. Richard Hatcher, mayor of Gary, Indiana. Charles Diggs, congressman from Detroit. And our own Amiri Baraka. And they convened the National Black Political Convention. I believe it was it Central High or West Side High? Central High School in Gary, Indiana. And you know, when the black flag issue came up, my poor mother, she would sit at home and the vice president of ABC television would come on and editorialize and tell her what a terrible person her son was for bringing the red, black, and green. There should only be one flag, the American flag. But let me tell you, the best feeling I had was when we came to Gary. We rode down the main boulevard of Gary, Indiana, to Central High School. Dick Hatcher had red, black, and green flags flying from every light post in Gary, Indiana in March of 1972. I was 18 years old then. I was probably the youngest delegate. And that was a convention process. People just didn't come to Gary. There were conventions held at the city level, at the county level, at the state level, and then the national political convention. Let me tell you, when I came to Gary, I thought I was in the black parliament. I mean, black people were passing policies. Hundreds of black elected people who had been elected, not elected officials, grassroots people who had been elected. I was so transfigured by that experience. After that, I asked Amiri Baraka to give me an African name. He gave me the name Adimu Chunga. So when I got back home, when they had the board dais, you know, with all the board members, I took out Lawrence Hamm and I put in Adimu Chunga. That same year, 1972, Newark attempted to elect, well, the 10th Congressional District attempted to elect its first black congressperson. See, Donald Payne was not the first candidate. He was the first one to win. But the first major campaign to get a black person elected to Congress out of this district was when Bill Hart, the mayor of East Orange, was the Unity Movement candidate for Congress. And he got 24,000 votes, just short of what he needed. But that was because there was what? There was betrayal. See, the betrayal started early on. See, when we had the community choice team in 1970 with Ken Gibson and Sharp James and Dennis Westbrook and others, they weren't just endorsed by the convention, they ran on a platform. So if we run in any candidates, any progressive candidates, any radical candidates, any Pan-African socialist candidates, they can't just run on their name and their good looks. They got to run on an agenda, on a platform that's put together by the people. So Hart lost, and we had several other elections. But then in 1984, Jesse Jackson ran for president. And see what happened, you know, initially, people talk about neocolonialism, which is a good metaphor for what's happening here on a domestic side inside the United States. But they wanted to keep the Jackson campaign, the people in power wanted to keep the Jackson campaign to themselves. So in 1984, there was the official Jesse Jackson campaign. We couldn't be in the official Jesse Jackson campaign, but that didn't stop us. We formed our own Friends of Jesse Jackson campaign. So see, you got to understand the dialectic of what was going on at that time. Yes, Jesse was running, and there may have been certain personal motives he had. There may have been other motives other people in power had. But it was exciting our people at the grassroots level. Now, we could have stood on the sideline and said, no, we're not going to have anything to do with that. But we said, no, we're going to jump right in it. So we formed Friends of Jesse Jackson. And we did voter registration. And we did our own events. And through that, we built up our political organization. I would dare say the People's Organization for Progress exists today because of some of the work that was done at that time. And the Jackson campaign caused a lot of people to register to vote. And what did that do? Well, one of the local struggles we had after that was whether the Newark Board of Education was going to be appointed by the mayor or whether it was going to be elected by the people. We had a referendum with a coalition called PUBS, People United for Better Schools. And PUBS successfully changed the Board of Education from appointed Board of Education to elect the Board of Education. But one of the reasons PUBS won that election was because of the new voters, the grassroots people who had been brought into the process as a result of the 1984 campaign. And then also one of the byproducts of that was the mayoral election of 1986. Ken Gibson had served four terms, but the people were tired. And they said they needed what? They needed a sharp change. And one of the reasons that Sharp James was able to win in 1986, I believe, this is one man's opinion, was because of the new voters that were brought in as a result of the organizing that was done at the local level around the Jackson campaign in 1984. In addition, Jesse ran again in 1988. What happened? Was it like 84? No. Our forces had become so strong that the people in power couldn't ignore us anymore. So they said, all right, we will sit down with you guys, and instead of having two campaigns, we'll have one campaign. Sharp James was a co-chair of the Jackson campaign in 88. I was a co-chair of the Jackson campaign in the area of 1988. And what happened? Did Jesse win? No, Jesse didn't win. But what happened at the local level? Donald Payne got elected. And he got elected because of the new voters that were brought into the process. People talk about the Million Man March of 1995. One of the things that's often forgotten about the Million Man March of 1995 was the fact that literally hundreds of thousands of black people were registered to vote. In fact, it was so deep that there was an article in the Wall Street Journal that said the only number, the only demographic group to increase absolutely and relatively in number of voters were African Americans. And they cited the Million Man March as a large part of that. So what as a result of all those, see, what I'm trying to get to is the mechanics of how do we seize power. Because make no mistake about it, if you want to participate in the electoral process, it's about seizing power. Nobody gonna give you a damn thing. You want it, you gotta take it. It's about being strong enough to take what you want. And it's really a measurement of real strength in terms of getting somebody in office. And this is something that we have to have a serious discussion about. Do we want to participate just to raise issues? Or do we want to participate to actually get people elected? Because there's a difference between the two. You can run a campaign in such a way to raise issues, but you're not going to win the election. Do you want to win, or do you want to just raise issues? This is a discussion that we have to have. And it's particularly relevant to the whole question of third parties. Because remember, we talk about the Freedom Democratic Party, but remember, the Freedom Democratic Party ran within the Democratic Party structure. It was akin to how the Tea Party is operating within the structure of the Republican Party. It was an independent caucus. Now, I've run for office independently. I ran in 1974 for the city council. I ran in 1987 for the state assembly. And I ran as an independent, not a Democratic primary. I ran in a general election. And you and I know, when you look at the numbers, in 1 year, in one election in New Jersey, you put all the independent candidates together, they didn't have more than 2% of the vote. You got to get, and this is something that we have to deal with. And I know people don't want to hear this. I know people don't want to hear this. But the question is, are we serious about taking power? And what are we willing to change to take that power? These are hard questions. You know, you say you want to be independent, but what if the game is so rigged that third party candidates can't win? You may have to run as like Charles Barron did, as an independent Democrat in the Democratic primary. Now, that's a hard pill for some people in this office to swallow. But these are some of the realities that must be confronted. We can't make believe they don't exist. And as much
as we are dismayed and disappointed about Obama, our constituency is going to run over us to get to the polls to vote for him on election day. Now, we could stand on the sidelines and make believe that this is not a reality, or we could try to use some of that energy. Why not engage in voter registration so after the Obama campaign is over, we can use those people that we registered in this period to in fact get some of the people we want to get in office. And I know it's a hard pill for you to swallow, and I know some of y'all are gonna talk about me, but I don't care. I'm not running for office. I ain't running. I don't care whether you talk about me or not. The other thing is we gotta be willing to fund the campaign. You wanna put somebody in office? We couldn't get up $1,500 in here today. You wanna put somebody in office, you got to come up with the money, because it's more of a money game today than it ever was. I mean, we talk this thing about freedom ain't free, but when it's time to collect the money, what's the practice? What's the practice? We gotta be able to come up with candidates, and when we put people in office, we got to keep them accountable. They have to be accountable to us. And I'm gonna tell you a secret. Keeping them accountable is more than just having a critique. You must have a critique because people must know the truth. But you also must have a structure, an organization, a political party, call it whatever you want, but you must have some type of machine that lets them know if they don't carry out the agenda that we sent them in there for, that we will take them out of there as fast as we put them in. Politics is a hard business. And if you approach it from the point of view of sentimentality, if you approach it from the point of view of not really understanding what you're dealing with, you can't win in that game. And I say, if we are to make the radical transformation of this country, because I'm going to tell you something. I support people running for office. I support Rasburg. The other thing is, we got to learn how to deal with failure. Just because a candidate loses the election the first time should not stop that person from getting back in there and getting back in there and getting back in there until they win. See, what happens is our candidates lose and then we quit. We throw our hands up. We can't win. But you got a kid. Look at young Ross Baraka. He had to run three times. He had to run as mayor, he had to run at large, and then he ran as ward, and then he won. We got to be willing to deal with the question of defeat and look at it as trying to incrementally increase our power. The future of our people depends on this. The truth of the matter is that black people are in worse shape today than we were in 68 when Dr. King was assassinated. We are in worse shape today. And it'll grow even worse if we don't turn this situation around. We must be willing to build up our forces such that we can really contend for power. It's a hard thing to call a meeting and 100 people show up. We're not going to change the system with 100 people. We could start with 100. We could start with 12. Jesus started with 12, but it took about 600 years for them to become a power. I ain't got 600 years. I don't want this change to be 600 years from now. I want it to be in my lifetime. I want it to be in your lifetime. I want it to be in our children's lifetime. I want to see universal health care a reality in my lifetime. I want to see reparations a reality in my lifetime. But all of these things we want will just remain on paper until we get to the point where we can call a demonstration. Not the nationally recognized leaders, but O'Malley Yashatel and Charles Barron. We sit down, we call a demonstration. We can bring out 25, 50,000 people out in the streets to the polls. And then those people are willing to put up whatever dollars are necessary for our victory. When we get to that point, then liberation will become a reality. Power to the people.
This panel another round of applause. I think it was an excellent job that they did. And at this point, what we want to do is to open it up for resolutions. So if anybody have resolutions, I would like for you to line up at the mic, wherever it is it over there? And we put forth some resolution. I'm going to start with Chimurenga. I know that there's some resolutions that from the panel itself.
Uhuru. So I'm gonna see if I can read my own handwriting. It's not that good, but I wanted to, with the permission of the Black is Back Conference, put this resolution on the floor for discussion. And please feel free to add or, I think that this discussion is gonna be really important for putting policy in place for the steering committee to vote on and move us forward. So this is the resolution that I propose coming from the challenging the bourgeois election electoral monopoly workshop. The workshop participants recognize and have unity with the report to the BIB International Conference, which states in part, elections within the capitalist colonialist system only serve as a nonviolent contest between different sectors of the ruling class for control of the state. Number two, let us use the electoral process right now as one form of struggle, but let us at the same time recognize that it is only one form of struggle and that our future depends on our willingness to build a real capacity to utilize every form of struggle in our quest for our liberation. Three, we must affirmatively declare that we will use all necessary means to wrench our freedom and future out of the grasp of a dying imperialist system. Based on this understanding, the BIB resolves to identify, groom, and run progressive candidates on a local and national level whose platforms are consistent with the goals of the BIB. In order to implement this resolution, the BIB further resolves to create an electoral politics working group resolved at the BIB International Conference Saturday, August 18th, 2012. Uh-huh.
He's a recorder. That's one of the recorders of the resolution, so he probably is trying to get some clarity. I want to ask if there's any other resolution on the floor? Okay. A resolution? We're going to be asking questions. When did we say we're going to do it? At the plenary?
Excuse me, I wanted a question about the resolution.
Okay. This resolution is coming from the floor, and then the Black is Black coalition. It's an organization of coalition. It's a coalition of organizations, and they will vote on the resolution of tomorrow.
Okay.
So any resolution could come through. It's not decided on yet. Okay. The coalition will tomorrow.
Okay. Thank you.
Anybody else? Okay. Yes.
I would like to make a resolution.
Okay.
Building a real third party, and as Larry Hamm said, that we use our struggles in our local areas, and I think Chimurenga said that too about local politics, that we build that and build an honest, straight ahead third party, because as you said, it takes a collective. It's going to take all the black and working class people in this country to overturn this system. And so I think the third party always comes up after the presidential election. We need to start fighting for a third party right now, so when the next election come around, we can have a real black person or a real, I don't care what color they are, as long as they represent the entire United States of America, particularly the working class and the poor people in this country. And I think we seriously need to have that discussion if we really want to overthrow capitalism.
Uh-huh. So did you get the recorders?
Yeah.
City council, going after the city council seats. And I think that that is a really good strategy that maybe we can employ, and that's what I want to propose for consideration on the steering committee.
You want to put that forward as your resolution?
Yes.
Okay. Did you get that?
Maybe Charles can write it down more clear in terms of what he meant, because when he said it, it was clear.
Okay. Yes, you. Yes.
Now, since this is an election year,
is why don't you get in line there and you can pose it. There's a brother that's standing. Okay.
I'm just seeking a point of clarity on the resolution. Since this is an election year, a national election year, November, the obvious question and the passage of this resolution is going to be, what is the position of the Black Is Back Coalition on the re-election of President Obama? Am I assuming too much here? Is that implicit in the resolution? Again, I'm just seeking clarity.
I think, are you talking about the one that was put forward by this sister here? The resolution you're talking about? Are you talking about all the resolutions collectively or what?
No, I'm talking about the main resolution that was put forward.
Oh, the main one that was put forward by Chimurenga.
Yeah.
Chimurenga.
I think our position is the one that we talked about in the discussion of the report, and that's that we were not, people have to make a decision based on what they understand. I was not trying to imply either way or the other. That resolution was about a practical way to move our organization forward in terms of trying to get involved in electoral politics.
Does that answer your question? No? Well, I think what was said, and I don't know if there's anything more that could be said, that this is just resolution that's going to be taken to the BIB body to make a determination on, of all the different organizations included in the BIB, that they will make a decision on that. And if there's a resolution that you want to put forward saying that a decision should be made in time for the election, that might be something that you want to consider, then I think it could come in resolution form. But everything here is just basically a collection of resolutions that's going to be taken to that body that can vote on it. We can't vote on it, those of us not involved in it. Okay. Okay, well maybe I'm not understanding. Is anybody understand that from the BIB understands the problem that she's raising? Wait a minute. I'm not understanding this.
Early on in the position that I was asking the coalition to consider and for this body to entertain was the fact that when we talk about Barack Hussein Obama, if we just make this revolve around Barack Hussein Obama, and we get a really subjective response from everybody who, for whatever reason, supports Obama. We feel like it's been a weakness of our whole movement and of this period, and we haven't had a real discussion around the question of electoral politics, what role it plays in our communities or in the world, in the capitalist system at all. So the discussion about Obama, we was hoping would happen within the context of a discussion around electoral politics, its possibilities, limitations, how we should approach that as a community, so that it's not around Obama as such. People have referenced Obama in this discussion, but we weren't trying to have a referendum here on Obama or asking the coalition to make a decision about Obama. So I don't know if that responds to what you were reading. Okay. Well, here's where we are confronted with. If I may just respond to what Sister Nelly is raising, and I want to treat it, you know, like as a point of clarification, is that, again, we say the coalition is an organization of organizations. And different people came into the coalition, different organizations, for different reasons. Some were Obama supporters, like Curtis Gatewood, who was the second vice, you know, president of the North Carolina, you know, NAACP. He was Obama supporter. Queen Mother Dorothy Lewis, when she first came in, Obama supporter. But they united with the coalition that held the first national demonstration against the Obama regime, not based on whether or not they supported Obama, but based on the policies that he was articulating, stood for, you know, like, et cetera. And I thought that was quite appropriate. And what we're trying to do now is have a discussion. You see, just from listening to this, I think everybody up here should be on this, on the Black is Back coalition, and should be playing critical roles in this coalition. But you can see, if you can hear, you heard nuances, differences in these folk, you know, who were involved in this discussion. So how do we build a coalition around principles of unity that are broad enough to allow for the full participation of all the anti-imperialist forces standing for self-determination while not so sharp as to push people out? You know, that's the thing that we're looking for. And we're also saying that the coalition, one of the principles of unity, is that we recognize and respect the ideological differences that exist inside the organization. But we do have certain principles of unity. And Obama violates some of those principles in terms of his, what he does, et cetera. So that's why we can have a demonstration at the White House, and that's why we can criticize and will criticize Obama, his cousin, and his cat. You know, based on these principles that all of us say, you know, like we stand for. And that's within the context of a coalition that is united around those principles, but has not united, as far as I know, around whether or not people should vote for or not vote for Obama. We think we put out enough information for people to make their own determinations. And I really think it's important for us to take this discussion out of this subjective place and look at the question of elections. Historically, scientifically, what roles do elections play in society anyway? With the election of a Negro, for example, change the character of a capitalist state? Will a state change because he's elected? And if not, can we surrender all the democratic space that has been won in the capitalist thing by saying we won't participate in an election? I mean, these are some of the questions that we are entertaining. And I appreciate, you know, because listening, I even learn from everybody that's up here, because I hear nuanced differences, you know, in the crew. And so I'm not you know, dogmatic around the question myself, you know, I think that's the best I can do in terms of, you know, I think responding to the question that you just raised. But I know, Comrade Sister Aisha and Gaida, I am not, you know, I've challenged the discipline of this meeting already with this long-winded presentation. I know we're working with a time factor, and so as the best that would say, I'm self-critical. And I just pass it on.
Yeah.
How's that?
I just got the 1 minute sign from the brother.
The brother has been standing up for
King. Good evening, everyone. First, I'm glad to be here. I learned a lot here. It's going to benefit me as I go through the struggle. I don't know how to frame this resolution, but just as previous minutes was mentioned, principles of unity. We all also got to look at the efforts to divide us. And I've been involved in quite a number of groups within here, the city of Newark. And there's differences amongst the groups. And this is a good step in reconciliation of those groups. But I think a session there really needs to be spent on the different organizations, turf battles, egos, and how we can ameliorate those differences so we can unify on the goals and principles to reach our goals. But I see that's an undercurrent in all of our movements, whatever domain we're pursuing, like I'm involved in the school board issues here in Newark. And I see amongst the different groups, people are worried about their benefactors or foundations, if they're gonna take their money away from them. They're worried about someone on their turf. But we need to look at those differences and how we can reconcile and hold each other accountable to fight those jealousies. Because it's there. If we don't look at that, that's gonna hurt us.
Yes. Very quickly, I know we are in camp.
Just a second. One second, please. Before. He's recording and he needs to get some clarity.
Okay. Strive to overcome the differences that have struck unity among and between black activists.
Yes. Yeah, we got to constructively go after that cause. It's the undercurrent in all of our unification.
Okay.
Yes,
we have to make it a resolution. All right, Kate Fang.
You know, very quickly, regardless of whatever our differences on all these questions of Obama or electoral politics, I think we need to put forth a resolution to fight this widespread move across the country of voter suppression.
That's what?
Almost 10% of the electorate in this country, most of them black, would may not be able to vote. From Florida to Ohio and to Pennsylvania alone, almost 750,000 to 1 million people might not be able to vote. So I think that's an important resolution.
Let me say good evening, all Miss Anita Senator. I got here late, unfortunately, and I apologize for that. I'm very thankful for this convening this today. Mike, I heard something very interesting on WBAI, George Galloway, I don't know if anybody listens to him, and he was talking about the choices that we have to make. We got two cheeks on the same horse. And he said that he would recommend that, that's his opinion, that we should support Obama. He said, because if you knew the history of the Mormon church, you know, where Romney is from, with Israel, he said, you would think twice. He said, yes, Obama has been terrible, but he feels after this election that he said he wants to come together and he would try to do what he can from in overseas, because, you know, he's in the House of Parliament, because he's just discussing what happens in the United States also affects what happens in Europe. And I thought it was a good critique. And then I heard another show where people were calling and said they weren't going to vote, and they thought that was in our best interest. So my position, well, I probably will vote for Obama, but of course after this I'm looking to, you know, let's just get some real change. Thank you.
Thank you.
Those who are interested, I think you should get a copy of the Black is Back book, and in it, Glenn Ford, he does a presentation on the electoral process. And I think that what he's talking about here is, what he's talking about is whether Obama or any other president can inherit a war, a policy, or is it just an extension of your imperialist system? So the book is worth getting. This is Black is Back is on the last stage.
All right, Uhuru, I want to thank everybody for participating in this project in this workshop. And I also want to remind you that the Black is Back, there's information on the table. People should get information, look at it, and make some decisions about everything that you've heard here and how best you can participate in the Black is Back organization. Thanks a lot. Uhuru.
I want to thank this dynamic panel, and I appreciate everything that was discussed here. Ooh, another round of applause.